Welcome.
Thank you.
You all should be in the session on improving research, what we know and what we need to know. If you're thinking you're someplace else, stick around. It's going to be far better than anything else that's going on in the rest of the conference. And although it may not look like it, this is probably the most heavily populated session in the entire conference at this particular moment, since I'm sure everybody else has gone out for drinks and someplace else. So those other ones are really empty compared to what's here. My name is Jim Kemple. I'm currently the executive director of the Research Alliance for New York City Schools at New York University. Prior to that, I'd spent almost 20 years at MDRC, the Manpower Demonstration Research Corporation, studying a wide range of employment and training, youth development programs for out-of-school youth, welfare to work programs, and school reform initiatives around the country. I'm really delighted to have the opportunity to moderate this panel discussion today. We've got a terrific, I think really on point group of four speakers who will each spend 5 to 7 minutes giving us some background on the evidence base and on the research in the area of pathways and what we know about the current state of helping young people make healthy transitions to post-secondary education, to work, and to healthy adulthood. I feel like I'm a little too young to be cynical and to be sort of reflecting back on almost 25 years of work now and work directly connected to the set of issues around youth transitions, and particularly transitions that include a real focus on the labor market and on work. But nonetheless, I'm sort of struck by the audience of folks here who, partly because of my new position and outside the world of MDRC, but partly because of the change in the policy environment in the intervening years between the mid-2000s and today, there is this deja vu moment, right? It seems like I haven't seen this group of people assembled in the same place in about 10 years or so. Many of the same issues and players are still connected to the work of school to work, career technical education, or whatever framework we want to put around this set of issues. And I keep wondering as I go from session to session, what's really new here? Certainly it feels like there's a few things that are not new, some of the faces, some of the issues that are on the table, but there are a number of things I feel both in the environment and partly through what we've heard in the discussion so far that do feel new, other than the fact that my two kids now are old enough, one of which to be an education researcher, believe it or not, and the other of which is running a work-based learning program in East Harlem. So fortunate to have two kids for whom this education reform school-to-work movement has had a real impact. I don't have the counterfactual for that because I've only got two kids, but it's quite gratifying to see at least something like that's different. I have to wear glasses full time now, and the last time I was connected to this set of conversations, it wasn't even a thought in my head at the time. But I do think, let me just highlight two things, and I think it's apropos of what we're going to talk about in this session today. I think one of the big things that's different now in education, and although I don't think we've framed much of the discussion so far in the conference here, that's very different is a set of issues around accountability. That's not quite research, but now we're in a world where as we think about public policy and as we think about practice in schools, it's taking place in the context of a real pressure to show results and to hold particularly the adults and the youth-serving institutions, be they schools, be they employment and training programs or vocational or career technical education programs, accountable for some outcomes and for some productivity in the service from the services that they are providing. And that feels to me quite different in many ways than what we were talking about 10 or 15 years ago or during the era of the School to Work Opportunities Act or even the earlier versions of the Perkins Act. So that's one thing that does feel different, and it'll be interesting to see whether, if any, role accountability will play in an effort to try to focus our attention back in a multiple pathways world where we're not just talking about college for all or the measurement of academic outcomes that have particular psychometric properties or an alleged value in the marketplace like a high school diploma. What part of what I think our panelists will talk a little bit about are things that we may want to measure or may need to think in terms of an accountability framework or not. I mean, I just think that's a piece of the environment that's quite different. The second is much more closely related to this session, which is around evidence. We're in a world now where I don't think, or at least didn't feel to me at the time in the early 1990s, where an evidence framework for decisions about practice and policy, and particularly about making good use of resources for the benefit of young people, is really front and center. We need, through things like Race to the Top, or investing in innovation, or even some of the conversation about the reauthorization of the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, are thinking hard about an evidentiary base for the use of funding, for the justification of funding, and also in particular for innovation. If we're going to innovate, we either need to bring to the table some set of evidence of promising practice or be willing to make a commensurate investment in building evidence around what works, what doesn't, for whom, and under what circumstances. And so as we listen to the panel discussion today, I think it's particularly important as this next round of a renewed focus, perhaps, on thinking about the range of pathways young people are going to take to post-secondary education, to the labor market, and to healthy adulthood. What role should evidence play? Can it play, both in helping us understand the nature of the problem and in understanding answers to questions about what works, what doesn't, for whom, and under what circumstances? So I'm really delighted to introduce a spectacular panel of presenters. And I think what I'll do is I'll introduce them one at a time. They'll come up in, I think, alphabetical order of first name, which is, I think, the way that they're actually listed in the program. If I had it my way, I would have done random assignment about who would have gotten in and see who got the bigger round of applause, not based on some preconceived notion of self-selection into the order in which they were going to speak. So I'll go and give you 2 minutes. Their biographies are in the binder that was handed out today, so I won't go into a lot of detail. I'll try to give you a little bit of sense of what some of the framework and perspective that they'll offer for us today. So in alphabetical order by first name, let me begin by introducing David Autor, professor of economics at MIT. And a research assistant at the National Board of Economics Research, among many, many other connections and roles that he plays out there. He's done a tremendous amount of work on the stratification of the U.S. labor market, earnings inequality, and the disruptive growth or the disproportionate growth of low-skilled work and jobs in the United States. He's also thought a lot about the issues of the tensions that arise between technology and education in the U.S. context. And so with that, let me ask David to spend 5 to 7 minutes providing some background and context in that set of issues.
Great, thank you very, very much.
So I'm not actually gonna speak about the school of work transition or things that make people successful in that. I'm not especially expert on that. I'm going to talk instead about sort of a big picture overview of labor market phenomena or trends that may impact opportunities for people who are not going for traditional 4-year college degrees. So one of the ironies of the sort of information age is that the computerization, technological change has increased labor's comparative advantage in what we traditionally think of as low skill, low education tasks, like food preparation, personal care, driving vehicles, lawn cleaning, while displacing labor in traditional middle-skill jobs. So clerical work, accounting, repetitive production tasks, machine monitoring and tending. Many of those jobs that I just gave in the latter list are kind of the good middle-skill jobs of old. The blue-collar production positions, and you might think of those clerical positions as the white-collar production positions of the kind of information age. Both of them are increasingly substituted for by machinery. And a very tempting inference from this is that advanced countries like the U.S. should give up on middle-skill education because middle-skill jobs have no future. And here's a picture you could point to make that case. This shows you percentage point changes in employment in major occupational categories between 1979 and 2010. So each of these bars corresponds to one of those 4 periods, 79 to 89, 89 to 99, 99 to 2007,
2007, 2010, I've just separated out the recession. And then these occupations are ordered by wage level from low to high. So in the bottom left, you have personal care, food cleaning services, protective services. These are what are called service occupations. They're not the service sector. The service sector sort of everything from software to bottom. The service occupations are jobs that involve helping, assisting, or caring for others. And these jobs generally require a high school education or less. And many of them don't require much formal training. People can be productive at them within a couple of days, typically. And you can see that they've been growing relatively rapidly. And even during the Great Recessionary period,
I think they need you to be closer to the microphone, otherwise you won't be recorded.
Okay.
So sorry about that.
Oh, I see. Okay. And even in the period of the Great Recession, you can see that they hardly lose any ground. The next set of occupations, operators and laborers, production, office administrative and sales occupations, these are typically middle education jobs, people with high school or some college education, and they're better paid than these. And as you can see, they have been losing ground. They've been losing ground for 30 years. They're not growing as rapidly as other occupations. And then if we move to the far right, this last category, technicians, professionals, and managers, these are college and post-college educated jobs. They're highly educated, relatively highly paid, and those have also been growing. So many people look at this picture and they say, there's sort of a barbell here. You have growth in the tails, growth of high skill, high wage, and low education, relatively low wage occupations. So looking at this picture, people say, ah, we should give up on the middle. And in fact, if you want to further persuade yourself of that point of view, you could look at data from the OECD. So here's data on 17 EU countries. From 1993 to 2006, those dates are dictated by data availability. And this is work by Goose, Manning, and Solomons. And they break occupations in each country into three broad categories. Service, clerical and production, and then technical, professional, and managerial. And these are ordered from the smallest to greatest growth of the high skill job, the high skill category. So this is, for example, Italy has the largest growth of high skill, and Portugal has the smallest. And then the other bars, the blue bars correspond to the change in the lower third of occupations, and the red correspond to the change in the middle third. And what you see, again, is that in all these countries, there's a decline of this middle group and a growth of the bottom relative to the middle. So this looks a little bit like, or a fair amount like the US, this kind of this barbell-shaped growth of employment. So many people look at that evidence and say, well, we should give up on the middle. So now I want to tell you why why I think that you should not reach that conclusion. I think there are three important reasons why we should not give up on, quote, middle education, why we shouldn't give up on middle-skilled jobs. First of all, on middle skills, on education, of course, education is cumulative, right? So people can't reach high skills without getting middle skills. So it's kind of crazy to say, well, we need to give people low skills and high skills, but not the middle, right? You can't learn calculus until you've learned algebra. You can't write great essays until you've learned, how to make a complete sentence. And so education is quite cumulative. It's critical that it be so, and moreover, it's from a pure equity point of view, you would want to expose everyone to that set of skills. But now, when we look at the labor market, I want to make a distinction between middle skill tasks and middle skill jobs. So many middle skill tasks are susceptible to automation. So repetitive information processing activities, things that can be scripted and programmed, are increasingly susceptible to automation. However, many middle-skilled jobs are not simply that. Increasingly, they're jobs that combine some technical skills with interpersonal skills and flexibility in a way that's very, very difficult to simulate. So, classic examples of this might be medical paraprofessional positions, like nursing, phlebotomy, x-ray technicians. Also skilled repair occupations, many of the trades like plumbing or electrical work or even construction work, many of these things combine. One, people have to have some real expert knowledge, usually acquired in a post-secondary vocational setting. And in addition to that, they need to have the adaptability and flexibility to interact with customers, to work in a changing environment. And all those things are will not be done by industrial robots within the next, you know, kind of 2 or 3 decades. And I have assurances from my colleague in the artificial intelligence lab at MIT that will not occur. So if it does, you have them to blame. So there's a lot of jobs in this category, and to give you a familiar example, you could let's say you call a help support desk, a tech support desk for help. Sometimes you call for help and you actually get someone who helps you. Sometimes you get a person who essentially is just reading a database out loud, right? And they're basically just a voice interface on a non-sentient system that's doing that task for them. And you ask yourself, which one actually works better? Which one leverages the capability of human tasks and human skills relative to one that does not? And I think the answer is the question is self-answering, right? We can see why there's a complementarity between that human flexibility and adaptability and the mechanization of certain information processing. So just to give you a little tiny bit of evidence on this, and I'm gonna close. I find it useful, it's not 100% predictive, but to look at the Bureau of Labor Statistics Occupational Outlook Handbook, which predicts changes in employment by sector, by occupation. This has a pretty good track record. There's a lot of noise, but by and large, they get it reasonably right. And you look at the categories that they predict to be growing more than average. So one of them is construction and extraction, healthcare, personal care and service, right? These are all generalized activities that are growing more rapidly than the average for the economy. If you look at their list of the 20 occupations that are predicted to add numerically the largest number of jobs, I've just put stars to the ones that are typically non-college positions: registered nurses, retail salespersons. Many RNs, of course, do have college, but not all. Home health aides, personal care aides, combined food preparation, heavy truck and tractor trailer operators, laborers, nursing aides, childcare workers, cashiers. I could go on, but the point I'm making is that when we think about the jobs of the future, many people tend to sort of look at at a sort of a narrow slice and extrapolate. Well, we know high-skilled activities are growing. We know the middle is going away. Therefore, everyone needs a 4-year college degree or above. And unfortunately, that's not attainable in time in the near future. Fortunately, that's not necessary either. And in fact, there's many activities that will grow in this direction. Let me close with one final example. Think about when you go to your doctor's office. There's so much new technology, it's making so many things so much easier, you would think there'd be fewer and fewer middle-skill medical professionals and more doctors. But in fact, it's going the opposite direction, right? Many more tasks are now done by your nurse practitioner rather than your doctor. One reason is cost, but another reason is because many of the technical procedures are now automated. What you need is a smart person who understands the big picture, can interact effectively with patients. That's a model for what many good middle-skill jobs may look like in the years ahead. Okay, thanks very much.
David, thank you. The other piece of this conversation will be after the four panelists are done giving their brief overviews. I'll try to structure a quick Q&A. I'll have four sets of questions that I want to pose to the panelists to start a discussion. But we should have about 20 minutes at the end for an audience, for some engagement from the audience and questions from folks of the panelists. Next, I'm really delighted that Jim Rosenbaum was willing to join the session today. Jim has been working this field from a number of different perspectives for many years. Most recently, and maybe most noteworthy for the purposes of this conversation, is confronting and asking directly and explicitly this very challenging question about, should college be for all? And this is a hard question to ask on many different levels, as Ron Ferguson pointed out earlier today. And Jim has been quite thoughtful, I think, in the things that he's written and talked about, in trying to come at that question in a very both conscientious and yet rigorous way. And in particular, what are some of the institutional hazards and enablers of that particular aspiration? Is that holding us back? Is that moving us forward? And how should we think about some of the institutional factors that are at play? And he's also thought a lot about this link between high school and secondary schools in the world of work and employment. And most importantly, I think Jim comes to this work with a deep commitment to making sure that he's using mixed methods, and most importantly, incorporating the voices and the experiences of the young people who are experiencing our educational systems, and particularly young people who've not been well served by many of our institutions, whether they be schools or transitional and linking kinds of organizations. And with that, let me introduce Jim Rosenbaum, who will give us some thoughts on, based on some of the recent work he's been doing.
Good afternoon. Jim, thank you very much. A very nice introduction. I have the answer to the question, should everyone go to college? I'm afraid so. And that comes not without a lot of qualifications. They shouldn't be going to what you and I went to. The four-year college is probably not something that everybody needs. And so the answer is partly, well, what do you mean by college and which kind of college? And then the other question is, for what? And that is going to be talking about what are the kinds of jobs that we really have in mind that and what skills are involved. And the other question is partly having to do with high schools and what we're allowing high schools to do. And I'm afraid that I did a lot of research in high schools over the 1990s. And in the interval, well, this always happens. While an academic is writing his book slowly, the world was changing underneath, and high schools were getting less and less capable of doing what we need them to do. I am not saying they can't do it. Some of them are. But fewer and fewer of them are. And it gets harder and harder. So the real question is not, is college for everyone, but what kind of college? And how do we arrange college? And how do we design colleges to serve the multiple purposes of a very diverse society and a very diverse economy? And I think that's what we haven't been asking enough of. I went back and reread the wonderful Pathways to Prosperity report, and it reminded me of the questions that we still aren't asking enough. And that is not about discrete programs that's this is good and that's bad, but how do things connect? What are the connections among them so that students in an institution actually see its connection to the next step and to a worthwhile career and a worthwhile goal? And then the things that they didn't ask that I've been looking at, and I want to talk just a little bit about today, is how do we organize those institutions, those high schools, and particularly community colleges, how do we organize them so that they offer meaningful experiences, ordered pathways, to really use that phrase, to allow young people to see that they're doing something towards a meaningful goal. And so we've been looking at community colleges, and we've been looking at how they organize their offerings. And we've actually, by comparison with private colleges, we've actually learned a whole lot that we hadn't thought even to look at. And I say private colleges, and immediately you say, oh yeah, that for-profit sector, and they're a bunch of frauds, right? Yeah, some of them are. Some of them are. Some of them are really quite exemplary and are doing some really good things. And so we wanted to learn how to do something different than what we ordinarily do. And so we went and looked at some of the better for-profit and non-profit two-year colleges that are oriented around a different model and a whole different set of procedures. And they do some things that community colleges could do but are not doing. Community colleges are designed by people like you and me, who have BAs and think with BA blinders. They think in terms of we have to design something just like the four-year college I attended. And that's not the only model. It's the only one we're going to think about all by ourselves. But if we look elsewhere, we can see other alternatives. And so I want to tell you a few things that we've noticed from the occupational colleges, the private occupational colleges that we've been studying. One is they use what we call an incremental success model. They actually create degree ladders. So you walk into a community college, the only degree you know about is a BA, so you say, I want a BA, and the community colleges give you a bunch of courses aimed at a BA. The privates organize a degree ladder. They say, fine, you're going to get a BA, but you're on the way, you're going to get a certificate within 1 year. You're going to get an associate degree within 2 years, and you get the BA after that. So you have things on the way. Organized in that way, it means if you have a chaotic life, and many low-income kids do, many low-income adults do, if you have risks of being forced out of college at any time, you may drop out after 2 years and not get all the way to the BA, but you'll have a certificate and you'll have an associate degree. Those are labor market payoffs you have even meanwhile, even on the way. Second, pathways. Create really clear, structured, ordered sequence of courses. We, in the BA world, we love electives, giving people lots of electives. That has led to massive amounts of credits that don't count, that don't accumulate. People get 60 credits and they still don't have an associate degree. They have 120 credits sometimes and they don't have an associate degree. Make sure that we offer a really clear pathway so that students know where they're going. Monitoring and mandatory advising. Now, this is expensive. I have to caution about that, but it has really big payoffs. For-profit colleges that care about the bottom line pay for this because there's a payoff. Some of it's not so expensive. Automating the registration system so you see when students are registering for the wrong course and notifying them right away, that actually can be done really cheaply. Notifying students when they're in trouble and seeing what needs to be done to fix that, that's not so expensive. They also do, the private schools also do mandatory, regular, frequent advising. That's expensive. It can be done with groups so that it's not quite as expensive, but it has real payoffs. Job placement. We think, well, you get a credential, of course you'll get a job. Well, that world was long ago and is no more. Job placement involves giving students a lot of advice about this really complex job market and showing them how to show off what their right skills are, what the right kind of jobs are. We have students who on their own are going to choose jobs that have no way of using the skills they've got. The payoffs for that are real low. And we've got good literature on that, incidentally. We should be looking at ways to make sure that students take the right kind of jobs. This is about research, so I don't want to just give my research findings, but the really important thing that was asked by already has been, what's new here? What's new here is the world out there is varied. There are a lot of really many dimensions of good jobs, and jobs offer not just earnings, which is the one we always study as researchers, but they also offer a whole lot of non-pecuniary job rewards. And things like autonomy, discretion, responsibility, challenge, impact, making a difference for people, making a difference for society, making a difference for your own life. Jobs do this. We traditionally don't look at this. Some recent research that I've been reporting on does do just this, and it's just really gratifying for students after they get out in the work world. We need to make them aware that these are payoffs that they should be looking for too, because they'll find them gratifying later on. Thank you.
Jim, thank you very much. We're up to the letter K, and let me introduce Kevin Hollenbeck. Kevin is the vice president and senior economist for the Upjohn Institute, and he spent well over 30 years. I just didn't want to continue to count through his CV and recollect a lot of the things he's worked on over time, but studying workforce development, employment and training programs, school to work, and other programs helping young people make healthy transitions to the labor market and to the world of work. To adulthood. Most recently, he's been studying interventions and initiatives in the state of Washington, in Indiana, Virginia, and Massachusetts. And he's been focusing on questions about work, about what works for whom and under what circumstances. Kevin has really invested a lot of his work over the years in trying to study programs and policies and practices aimed at supporting young people as they prepare for further education, but also for healthier transitions into the labor market. With that, let me turn it over to Kevin.
Okay, thank you, Jim. Today, I'm going to focus mainly on secondary CTE. I've done quite a bit of research in other areas of workforce development, but kind of complementing Jim Rosenbaum, I'm going to focus on my work at the secondary CTE level. I've been very fortunate to get funded by the state of Washington. The legislation there requires every 4 years for them to do a return on investment to all of their workforce development programs. So we just completed the third cycle of this, but we're looking at return on investment to all of the WIA programs, apprenticeship, voc rehab, post-secondary applied associate degree programs, but also secondary CTE. So I certainly appreciate their support. Basically, what we do is compare, it's a quasi-experimental kind of design. We match CTE students to otherwise identical students who are not pursuing CTE, and then we have several quarters of earnings after they graduated to sort of track earnings and employment and other kinds of outcomes versus this comparison group. So what I've put on the slide here are some net impacts for CTE graduates. The first column of numbers is short term. Those are folks that graduated in 07-08 school year. And the right-hand corner column, longer term, are folks that graduated in 05-06. And all of these data are, I think, as I say here, are statistically significant at very high degrees of confidence. And basically what the data show is that these students have better employment outcomes in the short term, 6 percentage points, in the longer term, 10 percentage points, better wage outcomes, 48 cents in the, per hour in the short term, $1.28. Incidentally, working in Washington is terrific from a research perspective because their wage record data, where I get these outcome data, actually collect hours of employment, so you can impute an hourly wage. CTE graduates work more hours per quarter from 22 to 48 in the longer term and have higher quarterly earnings. I would say that it is very, very difficult, and over the years it's been devilishly difficult to try to disentangle post-secondary experiences of students after they leave high school and how that confounds the outcomes. But this is for three cycles in a row, I have found these sorts of impacts. But even going back 30 years ago, Jim mentioned I've been doing this for over 30 years. I worked at the Center for Research in Vocational Education with a colleague, Paul Campbell. He consistently found payoffs to high school CTE in his work. John Bishop was also there. He consistently found it. It's been quite consistent over time that secondary CTE has positive economic outcomes. I actually, turned this these net impact estimates into cost-benefit ratios and return on investments. The first two columns show 10 quarters after graduation, the benefits and the cost to participants and to the public. And then the far right two columns basically extrapolate out to lifetime benefits and costs. And on the right-hand column, I've actually converted those to returns on investment. So the bottom row there, which I hope you can see, are the return on investment to CTE, as I can best estimate it, between 10.5% and 12% per year. depending on whether you discount and how you discount future earnings. For the public, it's a return of 6.6% per year. So the message that I'm telling the state of Washington is that CTE pays off for participants and ultimately to the state as well in terms of higher tax rates, tax payments, lower transfer payments in the future. So I want to turn my last slide to sort of thinking about research needs. Part of what we want to do here is direct effort into the future, and so I sort of thought in the area of secondary CTE, what are some research needs? And of course there's lots of research needs in post-secondary and adult education also. But in the area of secondary CTE, my first hypothesis is that CTE is an appropriate pedagogy for many, if not most, secondary students. And what we need is rigorous analyses of educational outcome data, such as achievement or completion, that control for student characteristics and school characteristics and so forth. So we need to control. An anecdote, I was a school board member for 14 years, president of my school board for 7 years, and I had one morning some students call me up and complain about the state assessment that they had to take because of all things that it had questions on serial versus parallel wiring, and they thought that didn't belong on an academic test. I mean, these were high-end academic students, and they saw no need for that kind of information. If we're going to change the world, I would say we need more CTE kinds of questions on these accountability tests. Second hypothesis I've kind of broken into two. One is I think we need more project-based learning. I'm a real advocate of project-based learning, and we need more good work-based learning at the secondary level. Another one of my soapboxes, I was an evaluator of school to work in the state of Michigan, and I visited a lot of high schools, and I visited a project-based learning program. My favorite class of all time. Here is a heterogeneous mix of students, some special ed up to very high end, and the school was right next to some undeveloped property. And they set up this 3-hour block class to allow these students to figure out what to do with this property. And so the students did some math, they mapped out the area, they designed a bridge over and built a bridge over a creek that ran through the area. They did some water testing, so they got science. Every week they had to write a journal of what they had to do. They had to talk to the city council to learn about zoning. They met with the service clubs to report what they were doing. It was just a terrific class. It lasted 1 year because in the next year the principal couldn't decide how to assign credits for that class. And so he instead of doing the class, he killed it. So project-based learning can work. I've seen it work. I think it's great. Work-based learning, of course, we've been talking a lot about that. Also, terrific. My soapbox on work-based learning is I've seen a lot of incidents where employers believe that just getting a student into the workplace will sort of magically transfer some learning. I think that you have to make some effort to reinforce the learning and have some assignments around the work-based learning as well if it's going to truly meet its promise. So thank you.
Kevin, thank you very much. Part of what what my prompts to the panelists will be in the Q&A are some of the things that Kevin is bringing up here. And I want to note the fact that he's listing these as hypotheses, okay? And I think that'll be a critical issue, I think, if this movement that Ron has been talking about is to move forward. And I think it will be important for us to move from the notion that the plural of anecdote is not necessarily data. So while these are good stories, and I think we've all seen things that we think, quote, work, I think the marshaling of solid, rigorous evidence will take more than adding up a set of anecdotes into data. I also think we should be clear that data is not necessarily, or not all data is evidence. And not all evidence necessarily gives us some insight, and most evidence, in fact, doesn't provide us with much good insight into the impact, the causal impact of a particular intervention. And I think what I hear from Kevin's set of slides here is pushing hard on this question of building evidence that provides us with really rigorous insights into what really does work, as well as for whom and under what conditions and what circumstances. So the panelists have been forewarned before they got here to start thinking about a set of questions we should be after as a research question. And following up on Ron's point earlier on, there'll be a sort of a call to action, and part of that call to action should incorporate some sense of what kind of evidence and what kinds of research should be done if we're going to go about this next generation of a pathway approach to education for young people and have it turn out to be a little different than past efforts. Any panel like this would not be complete without some international perspective. And Germany in particular has been cited both here and in almost any conversation about multiple pathways as one of the premier systems for preparing young people for the labor market through its extensive apprenticeship system and through its extensive systems for helping young people make really thoughtful and explicit decisions about the pathways they want to travel, not just to higher education, but into the labor market and toward adulthood. And I'm really delighted that Volker Rein, the senior research associate at Germany's Federal Institute for Vocational Education and Training, has agreed to travel across the pond and present some of the work that he's been doing in Germany, thinking about what might be learned from that context to inform a U.S. Approach to this. And it's delightful to see Bob Lehrman here as well, who's also thought a lot about apprenticeship and drawing from the European experience for here. So Volker, thanks very much for joining us, and 5 to 7 minutes on your work.
Yeah, fine. Thanks a lot for the introduction. Maybe just an additional comment to that, what we are doing, respectively, my personal experience. We are cooperating with our partner, the American Association of Community Colleges, since 10 years now. And on all these issues, career technical education, and what we are doing predominantly on apprenticeship system, the BIBB, that's a short abbreviation, is a hybrid. We are both a government agency in terms of keeping all the ordinances, how we call it, or ordinances, training regulations update, and we are part of the scientific community doing research on that, on skill requirements, on all, I can say, really all kind of aspects which deal with vocational education and more also in the field of higher education, I have to say this. But before I go more in detail on the famous German dual system, let me just turn the next one. Okay, I will tell you a story. Sorry, I'll tell you a story. I attended 6 weeks ago the annual Workforce Development Institute of the ACC in San Diego. So I had the chance already to have some spring days, and I hated it to return to Germany to the winter. And I listened to one of a very well-known keynote speaker, Tony Kahnweiler, the CEO of the Center for Education and Workforce. And he said, he gave a great speech, on the history of education policy of the last 30 years. And he said, we are now in the third wave of talking about the dual system, the apprenticeship system. And if we want to make this as a success, we have to look what has been done wrong in the perception of the German system in the 90s of the Clinton administration and in the 80s. And afterwards, I had a conversation with him. I worked with him 2 years ago. I did a comparative research on associate degrees in the United States. I was an affiliate researcher at the Georgetown Center. And at that time, and he repeated again, he said, work-based learning is okay, it's a necessity. Everybody will agree on it. but there are strong bias in this country, United States of America, among the employers to invest in this kind of education and training. So keep this in mind. So I hear both voices. Yeah, I listened today to all these speeches, and I saw the consensus. Everybody wants it. Everybody wants it. But still, we have to keep in mind there are strong bias. And why do I say this in the beginning? We have the same problem in Germany. We share commonalities. I tell you that. Why? Give you one figure. Only 25% of companies and institutions are offering apprenticeships. Keep that in mind. The rest is buying this from the market. So we're doing a lot of research and advisory work to convince companies to do this. Does that sound that familiar to you? Sure, sure. So we came up, for example, with research on cost-benefit. On cost-benefit, does it work? Is it a business model for the future? And we came up to the result, for example, not only on the middle skill level, but also on the higher education level, that the pathway to prosperity, to use the title of your project, is really a combination of theory and practice. Theory and practice. And the curriculum and the didactic approaches have to be changed, have to realize. Okay? So I show you the first slide. I know I have only 5 minutes and I talked already a lot. You see, transition challenge. What does it mean? And I want to correspond to your input, David. The apprenticeship system doing well, but the companies, what are they looking for? Well-educated school graduates. So we're looking at the gymnasium, the high school. We have apprenticeship in the banking sector. They only take high school graduates. Can you imagine that? So more and more and more, the labor market is asking for well-educated and well-educated school leavers. We have here a constant problem. In the moment, everybody says Germany is doing well, and so on. But we have a structural problem, and there is a political consensus in Germany about it, that 300,000, that's a big number, 300,000 youngsters are not covered, not having a chance apprenticeship. So the figure seems to be very low, 7.9 unemployment. But it's still a societal scandal, I have to say this, and everybody agrees it, that we are not able just to link them to the apprenticeship system. So we're doing a lot of research on that, and I cannot cover it now in my introductory remark. Maybe later on I can say something, what we are doing and what will be the outcome. And the other transition challenge is that the labor market is the driver in terms of permeability, how we call this in Europe. Yeah. That still, because of cultural, traditional perceptions, these are the privileged ones. The university guys always compete better when it comes to the management function roles and so on. We have also advanced vocation education and training part of the system. And what we do now is try to organize recognition of prior learning to make it sure, here comes the completion agenda in Germany, to make sure that those people who have already a lot of work experience, a lot of knowledge, maybe complete their bachelor or master at the university. So second slide. Okay. I leave this for the second part of our discussion, the demand. So I just concentrate on here. What I already said, there is it is proved that theory, practice, edutrain, I created another word, edutrain program. Why do I say edutrain? Because, you see, Germany is embedded in the European Union. And if you look at the euro, we don't do a good job. But if you look at education and training, we do a good job, really. And when we talk about, we never separate education and training. We always say in one sentence, and all these programs are run by the European Union, are covering both aspects. That's the reason why I call it edutrain. We believe that all curricula and didactic approaches have to redesign competency-oriented. And we are struggling now, what does that mean? How can we do that? You see, higher education, when they talk about competency or seeing something else, then those from the VET guys, vocational education and training guys, they're having in mind the task, the processes, the work requirements, and so on. So we have to tackle with the problem how to come to a common comprehension of competency. And this sounds very familiar to you as well. It is clear that credentials have to be designed in a stackable way. So if in terms of making a career, if somebody starts with an apprenticeship and we are working on that, these apprentices must be acknowledged in a BA program or whatever it is in higher education. Coming to finance, and then I close and then we continue the rest. Company training is self-sustained, but it's clear that public funding, the state, the government, must play an essential role in the apprenticeship system or on higher education dual degree programs. Otherwise, that fails. That is clear. So it must be a public-private partnership on all levels. Otherwise, that doesn't work. And I would say I stop now because I talked already a lot, and I continue later on what we think is the demand. And I came up with proposals here, which I think are very well known to the US context as well. Thanks a lot.
Boy, time and space are tyrants, aren't they? Sorry to have to constrain you behind the podium and the other speakers. We're trying to get this recorded so that the legacy of this will live beyond what we can keep in our heads and in memories. And it occurred to me after Ron pointed out, I should have, for the folks who prefer the walking around style, I've got this mobile mic that probably would have been more beneficial for you. So let me just post a couple of questions for the panel before we move to the audience. And we've got microphones here so that folks can ask questions, and those will be recorded as well. And I want to sort of focus on two types of questions. And I want to focus both of those types of questions to call out Ron's point at the outset about this notion of equity and advancing equity with excellence. And so as we think about my first question here, and as researchers, for those of us who are sort of thinking this world, we're always thinking about independent and dependent variables, right? Where the dependent variables are the outcomes or the goals or the objectives that we're aspiring to, those behaviors, those experiences that we're trying to influence. And the independent variables are either those things that are sort of proxies for what we're for the tools we're trying to use for influence, but for which we want to try to control for or hold constant so that we'll understand the real impact or the influence of a particular program, practice, or a field-based experience. So the first question for the panelists are, what kind of outcomes, what kind of dependent variables should we be most concerned about? Kevin put up on here employment and earnings. David put up here some questions about job quality, skill levels. We've talked a little bit about, Ron pointed out the idea of resilience or grit. Jim has pointed out a few other kinds of outcomes. So panelists, what do you think or what do you want to mark off for us as the most essential dependent variables or outcomes or goals that ought to be front and center as we think about both an evidence-building agenda, but also about a movement, if you will, and trying to document both the success and the challenges we face in a movement aimed at creating multiple pathways to healthier transitions for young people. And David, let me start with you, since you've had the longest to think about this, I guess, as far as the other panelists.
Actually, why don't you start with someone else? I don't feel I have a good answer to that one yet.
Okay, fine. Jim, go ahead.
Yeah, I began mentioning this, and so it's an opportunity to
pass the microphone down.
Oh, yes, sorry. The preparing people to get adequate earnings is crucial, and it's the one we analyze the most. And it really is important, but it's not everything. And indeed, among young adults in national survey data, when asked what's most important to themselves in their jobs, they will talk about autonomy, they will talk about skill variety, they will talk about careers, career preparation, advancement potential, health benefits. So there are other things that are important, and we need to be looking at those. The real issue, as actually the Pathways to Prosperity report said, is how do we prepare young people to become part of society, to be self-supporting adults, that is more than earnings.
Now you get the...
Now
you
I have one. Good. Okay, great. Actually, I'm going to refer to your research on the Career Academies work, which, and as many of you know, Dylan Kemple has done fantastic work studying Career Academies and the, their successes in enabling relatively disadvantaged kids to increase their earnings, labor force participation, family stability in the years after graduation from high school. And one of the, and so for those of you who aren't already familiar, Career Academies are basically, they're a traditional, a standard academic curriculum with a externship component where kids are placed in jobs during high school year and given support during the academic support to allow them to do this type of activity. And it, at the outset, when they first graduate, and this is a, I should say, randomized evaluation of good career academies, at the outset, the there's no difference between the kids who've gone through the career academy program and the kids who have not. And then you look out 6-8 years, they're substantially more likely to be working. I don't have the exact percentages off the top of my head, but I think it's on the order of like 20% higher earnings, less likely to be in jail, more likely to be living with their living with their significant others and with their kids. But one of the most striking findings for me from that research is that the types of jobs they're working in 6 or 8 years later are almost essentially uncorrelated with the type of jobs that they were placed in during the Career Academy. And so the puzzle is, you know, what is it about the Career Academy that's actually working for them? And I could give you two hypotheses, and I'll tell you my preferred. So one hypothesis is that, well, it wasn't the job per se, they just learned so-called soft skills about, you know, showing up, and that helped them to be successful in other realms. Another possibility, and this is the one I favor, although both could be true or this one could be false, is that they learn something about the possibilities of work that they didn't realize, which actually that there are a lot of decent, as Jim was emphasizing, decent, compelling, rewarding jobs available that you wouldn't know about if you're, you know, just in complete high school, you're not in an affluent community, and everybody you know, or many people you know who, you know, have their degree, they're doing something relatively menial. They're doing food service, they're doing cleaning. They're not aware that they're actually, you know, non-college jobs that don't suck, right? That are really yes. enjoyable jobs to do. and so hypothesis to be tested or not is that one of the benefits of career academies is people to expose people to the variety of different types of work that might be available, and to help them understand that there are many compelling things they could potentially do. So
an excellent point, I think, and you get nominated to take the next crack of that data set, and it is going to be publicly available, so you can get it if you'd like. I think the other remarkable thing about that study was that it showed massive effects on employment and earnings outcomes, particularly for young men of color, but no positive impact, positive or negative impact on educational attainment. Not because kids didn't go to college or because career academies aren't great college prep programs, they actually are, but because it didn't do any better than what was already available to kids in high schools. And yet, it was not necessarily the case that the more you learn, the more you earn. So in a multiple pathways conversation, this is the alternative pathway to higher earnings that didn't necessarily learn through higher educational attainment. And I think you're exactly right, David. What my little bit of torturing of the data to confess a few of these sins is that kids acquired the set of what I call navigation tools. It was just as important for students to learn that they didn't want to work in business, that they didn't want a career in the health professions, as it was for some of the students to learn that there were some options within that context that weren't quite the ones that they thought going in at the time. So I think that's just right. Kevin, you wanted to jump in.
Right. Well, just a follow-on comment to that is I'm not totally familiar with the Perkins performance standards now, but it used to be the case that training-related placements were important in what programs were being held accountable for. And so it's very interesting that you're saying that even though training-related placements weren't high, the students were still doing well with earnings. My answer to your question, Jim, I'm a labor economist, and it's really sacrilegious to hear that there's something other than earnings. but this isn't original. It's something Ron said this morning. It's college and career. And to me, I am a bit cynical. I remember 10 years ago or so, the school to work meetings and similar kinds of conferences like this. And so I think equity is a key question. We need to if this is going to take off, it really needs to be done in a high quality way. And there has to be equal quality to non-four-year college as there is to four-year college. In terms of the word college, I agree with Jim Rosenbaum. It's not four-year college, so I would say the outcome should be post-secondary, and careers are the key outcomes.
And Volker, let me follow up with you and sort of combine the left and the right-hand side of our regression equations here. You have things like a shift to competencies here, which I think of as a competency as something we're trying to produce a little bit more of, which suggests an outcome. But you've also got things about quality assurance. Help us think a little bit more from the German context about what are the critical outcomes that we should be paying most attention to, particularly if we want to think in a strategy that isn't just leading to a higher educational attainment, whether it's for its own sake or for other sakes. And on the other side of the equation, what are some of the independent variables, the interventions that we want to make sure we could test reasonably well to find out whether we're actually able to produce more sort of competencies, skills, things that may not show up directly in an employment and employment and earnings report.
Yeah. Thank you, Jim. I would have raised this from my side as well, the competency issue. I mean, there are a lot of folks in Germany and Europe who cannot hear the word competency anymore because competency seems to be transported as the magic driver for all and everything. And sometimes it became very obvious that many people understand different things with competency. Yeah. Okay, just this in the beginning, because so it's also a political issue. So to cut the long story short, there's really a strong demand because that in order to avoid that the very precious, and I take this very, very serious, an issue of competency orientation is tackled in a sustainable way. We have to face the fact that the different sectors, general education, higher education, and vocational education and training, how we call it, you call it career and technical education, really speak different languages, have different notions about competency. So we have to do research on that. And my assumption is that the sectors are much more closer than they think. What do I mean? Give you an example. Everybody knows we have done successfully a higher education degree program. Talked a lot about degrees, about contents, about theories, and so on. But as a matter of fact, in all industrialized countries, the academic graduates are doing very well on the labor market. Although explicitly the curriculums and didactic approaches are not very well linked to the so-called real world. But there must be something of value. So I think that the task is to make, and that is a good title, what Holly McKernan, everybody knows her, vice president of Alumina Foundation, and Tim Birtwistle, he's a retired professor of economics, I think, from Great Britain. They published an article with a great title, Make the Implicit Explicit. What does it mean? As I said, the higher education graduates get competencies, labor market competencies, but it's not very well outspoken in the curriculum. And what we have, what we need is a convergence of a common comprehension of competence without avoiding to cover the differences. It must be clear that career and technical education has to cover a different task than higher education, but there are strong convergence potential in order to come up with future design of curriculum.
I hope I catched a bit to point.
Good. Let me open this now to some questions from the audience. And I just want to just forewarn that I'm going to try to close that down about 3 minutes before and ask each of the panelists to nominate your sort of one priority for the call to action that we'll be reporting out on, in part tomorrow. So give some thought to, from a researcher evidence perspective, what do you think are the a central question or a central target for research that we should be advising the group for? Let me just caution folks. If folks have a question, we're looking for inflection at the end of the statement that suggests it's a soliciting a response. We know everybody's got great things to say, but in the interest of time and in the interest of trying to get as many people on the docket as we can, let's try to do this. One here and then one there.
I'm in charge of an entire state sort of leading, and I'm deeply committed to career and technical education. But as I have looked into the data, I feel like I'm in an intellectual whorehouse, and for some really specific reasons. If I ask, I go to audiences, and sometimes I'll ask them, what's the graduation rate for high school graduates? And of course, it's 100%. So if I take career and technical education high school graduates, and I compare their graduation rates to the general high school population, I'm going to be able to proclaim huge success for career and technical education. Our statistics are close to that kind of abomination. And the problem with it is that my understanding, and I would ask this question of you all, is that the NELS database shows that career and technical education not only isn't a marker for success, but it's a marker for lower outcomes. And if you're dedicated to career and technical education, you believe in it, what it means to me is that the system is all rocking around with slings on their arms for breaking their arms, for patting themselves on the back. And what we need is intellectually honest information so we can drive quality to achieve the outcomes that we know are great. When I look at the federal data, it's systematically, this intellectual illusion is systematically driven into the legislation so that we're comparing students, career and technical education students who are out of their junior year with general high school graduation numbers, and it's a complete illusion what we're doing. And all my people walk around patting themselves on the back when they should be dedicated to improving what we know are quality defects. Instead, they're proclaiming great success. And I, as I viewed your presentations up here, at least some of them, I viewed that same kind of problem, and it's embedded in your own studies, a failure to hold all things constant. Anyway.
So Jim, you spent a little time working on some national assessments of vocational education and thinking hard about this question of selection bias, and are we really measuring what career technical education is doing or just what kids are bringing into those classrooms and programs on their own?
I wouldn't have thought I was the first person to ask that question of.
We'll get to Kevin in a second.
I mean, you're raising really important issues, and we need to be honest about that, and we need to do corrections for selection biases. The people who go into some of the programs are on their second chance. This is often CTE is a second chance program, and so they've actually had a defeat previously. We need to be able to control for that too. There are some successes that we see in classrooms, and that's, I think, where the patting on the back comes from, where students discover interests and abilities they didn't know they had. And so we need to find ways that research can see that, but also do it with appropriate controls.
Kevin, do you have anything to add before we move on?
You have everything to add.
No, I agree totally that it's the covariates that you use in the regression that are very important, and I'm not sure NELS collects them all. I personally haven't looked at that data, so I can't say for sure. I would say, and I freely admit it, that it is very difficult to get returns to high school education because of the pathways that people take after high school graduation. And when I do the work, you know, I document how I've done it. I'm comparing graduates in CTE to the graduates that are not in CTE. They're all graduates. I couldn't agree with you more that CTE, there are definitely improvements that could be made to CTE. I don't want to be seen as someone that's promoting CTE as the be-all and end-all, because that's not what I believe.
Just, I mean, think that there's a simple answer to this question, which is randomized valuation.
Yes.
And then we don't have to worry about covariates or whether we're controlling for stuff because we have comparable populations, one of which is given encouragement or payment to undergo a program, and another comparable group that is not. And that can answer a lot of problems very definitively. I was talking about Jim's Career Academy studies. That was a big, expensive, long undertaking. I presume it cost, you know, tens of millions of dollars. But relative to the scale, the stakes, and the actual expenditure on an annual basis on these activities, it's peanuts. And the great thing about randomized valuations of that type is they can be very definitive. They have a huge effect on policy because you don't have someone standing up saying, well, you know, Senator, I don't think he controlled for the fact that the graduation rate was 100%, right? And so it's a type of societal investment we should make. We spend, you know, hundreds of billions a year in programs that we don't actually know their efficacy and are, you know, reluctant to blow $10 million on figuring out if they actually work. So these questions are completely answerable. Researchers have the tools, and there are organizations that are geared up to do them.
I know there's a lot of other points. Let's move on to another question rather than more answers, because I know I can see around the audience people who have a lot of direct answers with a lot more information on this. And I'd particularly point you to Bob Lehrman, who will be able to answer that pretty directly for you. Go ahead.
Michael Bettersworth with Texas State Technical College. On the Common Skills project, there's on the Common Skills Language for Unifying Curriculum, there's a project on that called the Common Skills Language Project. Richard Frischel, the labor market economist in Texas, has done a lot of work using detailed work activities, so I'd point to that. For the question, however, this linkage linkage between the level of education and earnings that was mentioned earlier, and I also think the assistant secretary made reference to having a U.S. News and World Report equivalent ranking for earnings outcomes. When we look at nursing programs, they have pretty common earnings outcomes. But you look at, say, computer science or an MBA, and the earnings are dramatically different. So the real question is, from a data perspective, how can we do a better job, the Department of Labor and others, in reporting earnings outcomes, instead of by level of education, by the subject area? Because that really is what's coloring part of the lens, the negative perception about a lot of these educational options, is the notion that the level of education dictates earnings, not the subject. It's not what that you study, but what you study. So how, from a data perspective, can researchers, the Department of Labor and others, do a better job of expressing those relationships?
Takers? Go for it.
I would caution against that. I think it's very easy to conflate the people in the program or the subject and the people who enter the subject. Just like, you know, you might find that students graduating from this institution earn a great deal more than people graduating from UMass Boston, but we really don't know how much of that is value added relative to the, you know, what they would have done in any case. So I think it's we want to give students, you know, full information. I would like that when we're talking about colleges, I'd like to say something about the graduation rates. I'd like to say something about the debt loads. But I would be reluctant to say, and here's what you can expect to earn if you go to this college versus that college, or do this major versus that major. Maybe in a very broad range, but that information could be taken far too literally.
Others, Ron?
I wanted to ask Volker to repeat what you said. What was the 25% number you gave? That sounded like it was 25% of the students go into apprenticeships.
Of the employers, of the companies.
Oh, 25% of the employers.
Companies and institutions.
Okay, maybe say it into the mic, because I want to be sure we got it over.
Sorry. Okay. It's fine that you had to raise that, because just to avoid misunderstanding. 25% of the companies and public institutions are offering apprenticeship only. So we have the ongoing big challenge, like in your country, to motivate companies to offer something like apprenticeship or other forms of work-based learning.
And what percentage of your young people go through apprenticeships?
So another good question. It's roughly, when it comes following the last national education report, 50%. 50%. Another 7% are covered by full-time vocational education and training schools. 17, we are blamed for this at the OECD, 17% only are higher education graduates. And here it comes, 28% of the German adult population doesn't have any occupational degree or whatever certificate or so, but they're doing well.
Okay, and for the students who come out of the earlier part of the education system with very few skills, they're struggling, they don't read very well, they don't do math very well, do they have a problem getting into apprenticeship programs?
Right. That is the first transition challenge, yeah? And the labor market doesn't accept it. That's the point. And those kids are covered by so-called preparatory vocational education and training programs to bring them finally in the apprenticeship, but they're not very well accepted. And the number of those 300,000 young people is still constant, although Germany is doing well, and it's a societal problem. And all parties are complaining and nobody knows it. And we have one example how they try it. And here comes the point stackability. What we recently tried and started with 14 national occupation standards to train those young people in one or two modules. When they're doing it well, then, so what are part of the occupation? When they're doing it well, they might have the chance to get this recognized in an apprenticeship. So we try to link it, yeah. But we don't have just now valid data about it. What is the outcome in the long run? We don't know.
So I really apologize. I'm sure there are many other questions and thoughts on folks' mind. I strongly encourage you to come up, have a conversation with the panelists. I think we have till 6 o'clock before the cocktail party starts, and you guys can sort of continue the conversation on up the stairs. If I can take the liberty of using 30 seconds from each panelist to give us your nomination for what you think should be the top priority for a topic, a question, a line of inquiry for research, if this movement for a pathway approach, a multiple pathway approach to healthier transitions for young people, what would you nominate that for? We'll go in reverse alphabetical order by last name. So Jim Rosenbaum, you're first.
The Pathways Report is focused on the interrelations between institutions. The interrelations among institutions, and I think that's where we really get mileage. We get incentives, we get direction, we get a sense of progress. I would stress that, and research can play a part in helping to coordinate that.
Great. Volker, yes.
So what I see is the ongoing demand, as I follow now the US education policy and since 10 years now, is just to make really a lot of research how to create stackable credentials. Yeah, the transition issue is very, very crucial.
Kevin.
Right. David was exactly right that we need random assignment, RCTs. I think my slide talked about they don't have to be big, expensive experiments. We can do RCTs and try to get inside the black box of programs, looking at random assignment at a school level or district level, that sort of thing. Testing project-based learning, testing work-based learning, testing other types of delivery.
Great, David?
I would like to better understand what are cost-effective, time-effective ways to get people who are, you know, early in their high school career aware of job opportunities that are not on the four-year college track, and you know, get them the kind of exposure that makes them think, A, it's worth completing my degree, and B, I have something to shoot for when I'm done with that. And that, you know, very much following up from the discussion of career academies and how those appear to work. I'd like to better understand that.
Terrific. Thank you all very much. Thank you all for your time and for doing this session. Terrific. Thank you all very much.